Turkey, transition from Ottoman to Republican Turkey, and of course sociological theories about all these sociological theories about continuity, discontinuity, about transition, about state and society relationships, about state and class structure of the society, state, class structure of society, and economic structure. These are all topics that we are going to discuss in this class. Now, today, I am going to discuss the world system approach. Now, some of you who are in the fourth year are exposed to Wallerstein's The World System Approach. I am going to briefly review that approach of Wallerstein's, and then I go into Kedar's approach, which is also a world system approach, but applied to Turkish transformation, Turkish modernization. So let me first show to you that in the blackboard, when I am going to discuss on Wallerstein, I included material, a rich material. Now let me share and let me show, and then let me continue as usually I do. Let me share my screen and here, this is the one I am going to show you. Okay, now this is Wallerstein, and mainly I discuss his book published in 1999 and translated into Turkish as well. Bildiğimiz Dünyanın Sonu, a Turkish title, the English title, The End of the World as We Know It. Now, from this book, I will try to summarize Wallerstein's world system approach. Now, here I put a short article, actually an obituary, because we lost Wallerstein in 2019, 2 years ago. And here I put my blog spot about two sociologists that we lost in 2019, Emmanuel Wallerstein and Eric Olenright. Now you can read what I wrote when we lost them, at the time we lost them. And Çağlar Kayder wrote an obituary, an evaluation on the event of Wallerstein's death. So you can read that. I put here a longer discussion of Emmanuel Wallerstein's approach. That is my one of my introductions to Wallerstein, a video. So you can listen to that. And now I come, I will come to the end of the world as we know it. And here I put a summary of it. And also I put a commentary by Wallerstein, the last 500 commentary, the last commentary he wrote in 2019, few months before he died, he stopped every 15-day short article that he used to write, evaluating various countries in the world from the perspective of world system analysis. And he promised himself that he will stop when he wrote the 501. So imagine from 1998, 2019, every 15 day, that is two times a month, he wrote this, and the last one is here. And then I put here a summary of some relevant chapters from the end of the world as we know it. I will not go into it, but those of you who are interested, those of you who are curious that next year you will know more in detail, so you will take a look. So let me send this away, and let me then try to focus. Actually, one of the chapters in this book, The End of the World as We Know It, is on social change, that is chapter 8. Here he summarizes world system approach and the modern, the emergence and development of the modern world system. However, before he goes into that, at the beginning of this book, he talks about some assumptions, some premises, that is, and he draws some conclusions on the basis of those premises. So maybe briefly, I have to go into that, and the because his world system approach is based on these premises, and then the conclusions he draw. Now, The End of the World as We Know It, actually the title itself implies two parts of this book, The End of the World. Now, as we will see, he says that the world system that started during 16th century, the middle of 16th century, even sometimes he puts it into 15th century, and he thinks that it will end in 21st century, sometime in 2050. You will see, it is a prediction that it is made by him. Because he says that in order to understand human societies, we should study historically the world systems or historical systems that existed before capitalism, and with capitalism, the capitalist, the world system. Now, before capitalism as a system, there were Roman Empire, for example. Ottoman Empire was already in, you know, from 13th century onward, actually 14th century onward, it was there. The Chinese Empire, the Indian Empire, the Inca, Maya, these are historical systems. Now, most of the time, those historical systems repeat themselves. For example, he gives how, for example, in China, the Han dynasty period, so many hundred years, ends, and Manchu dynasty period starts. But as a historical system, Chinese system was the same system, and there was not a radical change. Whereas in Europe, a radical change took place. A radical change from feudal system, which was a cellular system of lords and serfs, gradually developing into a new class system, emerging lords consisting land owning aristocracy and state formation. You might have studied Elias in your second year history of sociology, Norbert Elias, where he talks about this state formation, this 500 years. He also talked about this 500 years. He talked about the sociogenesis, that is how the capitalist state, the nation state emerges, and how and a capitalist economy and a class structure parallel to it, a stratificational structure, and psychogenesis parallel to it. Now, similarly, Wallerstein talks about a similar transformation of this capitalist world system that started to emerge in 15th, 16th century in northwestern corner of Europe, northwestern corner, England, Holland, France, those three countries, eventually Germany being included. Now, he says that now the premises about these systems generally, the first premise is that all systems have finite lives. It has a beginning, it has a long development, and finally, a move far from equilibrium, which is when the system was dominant, to bifurcation. Bifurcation and the end of that system and the beginning of new system or new systems, okay? Or the same system continues with some transformation in its basic structures, because according to Immanuel Wallerstein, capitalist world system came to its end because the world is not anymore able to supply the energy and raw materials without destroying itself. And the world, the earth, this limited natural resources of air, of water, of all other animals and life in general. Now, the capitalist world system made use of it in to such a degree that it is not anymore, it is not able to sustain itself. Sustainability, there is a basic sustainability problem. It cannot sustain anymore. So it enters into a bifurcation. And during bifurcation or transition, if we compare it during the system phase, in the system phase, large outputs results in, no, large inputs results in small outputs, because system tries to restore equilibrium, a moving equilibrium, but equilibrium nevertheless. Whereas in the time of transition, bifurcation, small inputs may give rise to large outputs. And this is from chaos theory, chaos theory. According to chaos theory, you know, this is a joke actually, but illustrates this point very well. Small inputs leading to large outputs, like if meteorologically, like if a butterfly puts its wings, violently, but a small butterfly, it might result to the other end of the world. It might result with a big storm. Not small input of butterfly's wings, and a storm. In the weather now. And hence, in the time of bifurcation, indeterminacy that Bauman, I don't know whether you encountered Zygmunt Bauman. Bauman also talks about indeterminacy in the second phase of modernity, when he talks about solid modernity and fluid modernity. Anyway, now the third premise Wallerstein asserts is that, I already said it, that this capitalist world system entered into its terminal structural crisis, and hence it will end in some time. You see, in those 15-day articles, short articles, he was looking for whether there are any signs of this transition, but in his last 500th article, he said that he will not see it. And as a matter of fact, 3 months later, he died. He couldn't see the transition. But I don't know whether I will see the new world system or systems. And Wallerstein says it could be better than this existing system if human beings, societies in the world, individuals even, contribute to its a better shape, or it can be worse than this one. It's more oppressive, more exploitative, but it will be either it will be fragmented, or it will be at the global level. So this is indeterminate. We don't know. So these are the premises. And then he draws conclusions from the premises. And the first premise is that although Enlightenment rationality, modernity in its first phase, asserted that humanity, human species entered into an inevitable progress, change towards a better condition. Now, unfortunately, the 500 years of modernity, or according to Wallerstein, capitalist world system, has shown us that progress, it was not a change towards a better societies. Now, as you know, there are world wars, First World War, Second World War, where some groups in the society, for example, in Germany, with the rise of Hitler and coming to power of Hitler, and starting of Second World War and eliminating 6 million Jews, for example, Holocaust. Now all these, or the poverty or unequal income distribution existing in the world. On the one hand, there are 1% of the world population owning more than 50%, and the lower 50%, the lower 50% owning so little of world's wealth, especially lower 20%, even 30% are hungry, in poverty. So it is obvious that Wallerstein says progress was a utopia that did not come to be realized. It is not realized. So we have to see that instead of a development, an economic, technological, scientific development, which is limited to instrumental rationality. So instead of instrumental rationality, we have to have substantive rationality. He borrows this concept from Weber, which takes into account not only means-ends relationship and tries to maximize, like in capitalism, profit without any consideration to the ends, to the values, to the moral consequences of what they are doing. Now, substantive rationality take into account also moral consequences of our activities. So now, in the time of transition, the second conclusion, the uncertainty. This uncertainty, the end of modernity's certainty. Uncertainty is disturbing. Yet, it also contains a promise. Now, this uncertainty might give rise to new elements that human societies will be able to go beyond their existing world system and its oppression, exploitativeness, and its oppressiveness, and create a more equalitarian, a more free societies. This uncertainty might give rise to that. And thirdly, that human social systems are most complex social systems. Now, physical systems are also systems there, but they are physical. Okay, for example, the sun and the planets around it. Newton discovered, the Earth included being one of the planets. It's a system. It's a physical system. You can write the laws of it. Then there are, for example, molecules in chemistry. Then biology, the organisms, okay, from single cell organisms to multiple cell and through fish, birds, mammalians, and finally human species, Homo sapiens sapiens. Now, Homo sapiens sapiens has the capacity to establish most complex systems. So, but that complexity is such that it can collapse, or human beings should make it sure that it will not collapse and it will evolve in a better direction. That is what he put. He makes actually this is his fourth consequence from the uncertainty, indeterminateness, and from the condition of its entering into a transition. Human societies should be able to create a more egalitarian and more democratic societies, or more egalitarian and democratic world. Okay, now I was going, now this initial introduction took long, but before I finish Wallerstein's world system approach basic points, basic concepts, I have to say that when he goes into the analysis of transition from feudal system to modern capital system in Europe, and how from northwestern corner it constitute a center, and gradually through 17th century, 18th century, during 16th and 17th century, for example, Holland, the capitalists, the merchants from Holland, were more hegemonic, more dominant in the world. You know, they were going to the rest of the world together with England, taking over, for example, with their firms of India or Indonesia, England, India, Holland, Indonesia, and integrating them to the world system. So the world system consists of two basic elements: the core, which were first Holland, secondly England, and after Second World War, United States of America became hegemonic, dominant, and Wallerstein says America's hegemony is also ending. It started to decline from 1980s onward. Anyway, now the center and the periphery. The periphery. The center were those three countries, and the periphery were India, Indonesia, Africa, Latin America. Latin America. You see, from 1492, Christoph Colomb, discovery of Americas. Now that is 15th century. Now in 16th century, all the wealth, riches, gold and silver of Latin America and North America, South and North America, were brought to Europe, and which led to a great inflation, which led to inflation during 17th century, 16th and 17th centuries, 16th and 17th centuries, which also influenced Ottoman Empire. And as we will discuss, it led to a transition from its classical state and social state and society system to a decentralized. We will see. We will come to that. But now, the world system approach: two elements, center, which dominates the rest of the country. Now, the center, the countries in the center usually are producing goods, capital-intensive goods, technology-intensive goods, whereas in the periphery, it is raw materials and labor-intensive production. And there is a third element in between, semi-periphery, semi-periphery. Now, for example, rest of the Europe, Eastern Europe, even Germany, and Germany tried to enter into the center. Spain initially was and Italy, Italian cities in the 13th, 14th centuries, and they were more central. But as Holland became hegemonic, and then later England became hegemonic, then Spain and Italy and the rest of Europe became semi-peripheral, semi-peripheral. In all those semi-peripheral countries, under the dominance of central countries in the center, by the middle of 17th century, they formed nation states. A nation state system is being formed, its development. And then gradually it peripheralized, you see, first it peripheralized Spain and Italy and other Eastern European countries. And then it peripheralized Ottoman Empire, because Ottoman Empire, as I said, according to Wallerstein, was a system, a historical system in itself. Now, it could have, and he says somewhere that, you see, why Europe developed into a capitalist world system? Because the previous, the Western Rome and the upper classes of at that time, were destroyed by the invasions, and at one point, Mongol invasion also stopped without going into details. So it was possible in Europe for the emergence of a new upper class, the lords, the aristocracy, and a bourgeoisie, state formation, eventually leading to first empires and later transition to nation states by middle of 17th century and especially during 18th, 19th centuries. So this center peripheralized previously previous systems. Now, it in the early times, it peripheralized India. Peripheralization of China and Ottoman Empire and Japan, you see, peripheralization of these countries, one can compare at which time, of course, at that time, Germany was rising, but England was the dominant hegemonic power, French competing with it, Germany competing with it. And these powers, competition of these powers, determined peripheralization and transformation of Ottoman Empire. So let me stop here and let me go to Çağlar Kejder, who applies this approach, this peripheralization, this world system approach to Ottoman Empire and to Turkish Republic. So now let me open my page and show to you Çağlar Kejder's what I have prepared for you here. I will quickly share it with you. Let me see. Let me go again and share my screen with you. And here, and here, it will come. Okay, now I can make this a little bigger, like this, perhaps, yes. As you can see here, there are information about his education, where he worked. As you can see, he worked in New York City, SUNY Binghamton, at State University of New York at Binghamton, has a sociology department where Wallerstein was the chairperson, and Kejder was a faculty member there one semester, and the other semester he was a faculty member in Boğaziçi University. You see, he was alternating between Binghamton State University of New York Sociology Department and Boğaziçi University Sociology Development. He was also in Boğaziçi. He was in Atatürk Institute of Modern Turkish Studies, both in sociology and Atatürk Institute. So you will we will see with you next year when you come to the fourth year. We will go into more detail. For example, he a recent books, The End of Agriculture as We Know It. This semester, in the second semester, we will go into that. The Collapse of National Developmentalism, From Ottoman Empire to European Union, New Poverty and Changing Welfare Regime of Turkey. You see, definition of peripheral economy, imperialism, underdevelopment and Turkey, ways to modernity, Greece and Turkey, comparing Greece-Turkey, Istanbul, he has a book between global and local, and the book that we will use, State and Class. State and Class. Here I put again one of my lectures, YouTube videos on Çağlar Kayder. If you like, you can listen to that. And also here I put an interview with Çağlar Kayder by Tuna Kuyucu, a sociologist, a student of Çağlar Kayder. He asks questions, you know, how he came into studying agricultural structures in Turkey, transformation of agriculture. As a matter of fact, in the beginning of the end of 1970s and the beginning of 1980s, I worked with Çağlar Kayder and Nüket Sirman and Ayşe Saktanber and other friends. We went into the villages and we tried to develop paths of rural transformation, how different villages, depending on their location and structure and their what they produce and social structure, they follow different paths of transformation. Okay, we will come to that in this during this course. We will go into that research and other rural sociological research. So you will read this interview and you will know more about him. I also put here a video by himself so you can listen to him directly. Now, in order to come to that book that we will be using, some chapters of which we will use during this course. But before that, I will review an article that is published in 1988. Now the book, now this article is Bureaucracy and Bourgeoisie, Reform and Revolution in the Age of Imperialism. Did you, let me see. Did you see that? Yes, here. Bureaucracy and Bourgeoisie, Reform and Revolution in the Age of Imperialism. So here he goes into various approaches how Turkish revolution, Turkish transition from Ottoman to Republican is being studied, and his approach. Now let me send this away, and again let me come face to face with you. Here in this article, Kayder goes into various approaches, as I said. By the way, this this article is published in the review Fernand Braudel Center. It is a journal that is mainly publishes studies, research based on world system approach. So this article is also published in that journal. And actually, it summarizes, now it is 1 year after the book was published. So he looks at his book, State and Class, from a distance and locates it in comparison with other approaches. Now, the first approach that he goes is Barrington Moore's famous, I also used Barrington Moore's book in my books and also in my classes. Now, in 1966, Barrington Moore published a voluminous book called Dictatorship and Democracy, and subtitle Lord and Peasant. Lord and Peasant. Now, in this book, he identified three paths of transition to modern world, in the world. Three paths. Now, the first path he identified as a bourgeois democratic revolutions from below. So this is the British England and French United States. United States 1774 and French Revolution 1789. Actually, British Revolution is 1688, 17th century. A bourgeoisie emerged gradually and struggled with lords, with landlords, with aristocracy. So the nation state transformation of monarchical absolute state. And here remember Foucault's forms of power. Absolute state, the first form, disciplinary modern state, second form, and biopower, third form, biopower, disciplinary power, absolute power. Now, in Europe, absolute power or monarchy was transformed by a rising bourgeoisie and in England, for example, balancing aristocracy. Now, aristocracy is not being eliminated there, but the king or the queen became symbolic. Monarchy became symbolic. Whereas in France, the contrasting revolution from below, bourgeoisie came to power and eliminated the aristocracy. So the French Revolution, so absolute state was being transformed into a nation state, a transition from monarchical to parliamentary democratic capitalist state. A capitalist state is being established by the bourgeoisie. Bourgeoisie came to power there, whereas in England, bourgeoisie shared power with aristocracy. In America, I mean, in the American Revolution, it was a colony of England, and bourgeoisie, the American bourgeoisie in the colony, rebelled against the imperial dominant British. Power, British dominance there, and they transformed the colonial state again from below, into a capitalist nation state, a federal capitalist nation state. Okay, now these three examples from below. Now Germany did not enter into this path, couldn't enter into this path. You see, in Germany, bourgeoisie was weak. and landed aristocracy and the army that they and the state were strong, although in 1830, 1848, and several times bourgeoisie tried to come to power but couldn't until the end of 19th century. Now, only around 1870s and 80s, a parliamentary was being established, a parliament, but still, so it was not actually the development, industrialization, economic development, partly was carried out by bourgeoisie, but partly by aristocracy and bureaucracy that was dominant in the state. So they united the principalities in Germany. Bismarck, for example, is one of the emerging statesmen in. So this Barrington Moore called revolution from above, and a bureaucracy, a state established or a part of the previous state, pre-capitalist, pre-modern class became dominant and established a repressive authoritarian nation state with a limited democracy, and as you know, after its being established, there were the First World War, because Germany tried to enter into the center and challenge British power and French, and Dutch was already subordinated. Ottoman Empire also entered on the German side, as you know. And after 4 years of war, Germany and Ottoman Empire lost, and hence Austrian-German Empire ended, Russian Empire ended, and Ottoman Empire ended as a result at the end of the First World War. He said, the point is that Barrington Moore talks about a second path to modernity, which is a revolution from above and transformation, establishment of a nation state, and a formal democracy. Since bourgeoisie is not very strong, it is not a full democracy like in France or in America or in England. Okay, and then Barrington Moore identifies a third part, which is peasant revolutions in China and Russia. Now Çağlar Kaydar goes into this, but especially he goes into a student of Barrington Moore, Alan K. Trimberger. Alan K. Trimberger published a book about revolutions from above, in which, and this is published 10 years after Barrington Moore's book, in which she focused on Germany, Japan, Turkey, Egypt, Peru, how in these countries, similar, so Germany is the model of the analysis. The people who studied Ottoman Empire, transformation of Ottoman Empire and establishment of Republic from this point of view, Alan K. Trimberger's approach, and similar approaches. So as revolution from above by a bureaucracy. So first state exists and state and bureaucracy and bourgeoisie, weak bourgeoisie, struggle, okay, struggle. but bureaucracy is dominant and hence it is a revolution from above. So this is one approach. The second approach, Çağlar Keyder identifies as a perspective, a neo-Marxian underdevelopment approach. Now, in this approach, there is some similarity to world system approach, dependency approach, but André Günther Frank, instead of Wallerstein's center, periphery, and semi-periphery, André Günther Frank had center and periphery. Center and periphery. He especially studied Latin American countries' peripheral status, and for example, one of his observations, when the center is weakened, like during the wars or during an economic crisis, as capitalism cyclically enters into crisis, then some industrialization and economic development takes place in dependent peripheral countries, dependency approach. Now, Ottoman Empire also, how Ottoman Empire's development, change, transformation, and emergence of Turkish Republic, Turkish Revolution, is studied from this dependency perspective. And in this perspective, bourgeoisie is taken as an extension, as an extension of Western bourgeoisie, and the state is not given much autonomy, like in the first one. Only after Turkish revolution, Republican revolution, state becoming active, but still after a period becoming dependent again. This approach, especially singles out 1938 treaty with Great Britain, how Ottoman Empire, the state, the ruling group at that time, Mahmud II and the bureaucracy, how they were forced to promise to transform Ottoman Empire in accordance with the expanding world system, in accordance, according to interests, in a sense, of establishment of a world capitalist system in Ottoman Empire as well as in the rest of the world. So this is the second approach, but he criticizes this approach because state is given, bureaucracy is given a dependent role, and the Tanzimat mind is being criticized, sometimes rightly, sometimes wrongly, according to Keyder, it leaves some developments unexplained. The third approach is orthodox class analysis. Now, according to this approach, economic transformation during 19th century set the stage for bourgeois class position. Now, in this one, bourgeoisie is given a prominence, but like in the second one, but they are somehow accommodated to the expansion of world capitalist system from Europe, and then they go into 1908-09 Young Turk Revolution, and 1923 again establishment of Turkish Republic, and now with, in Young Turk Revolution and Kemalist Revolution 1923, the previous comprador bourgeoisie is being eliminated during the First World War, and a national bourgeoisie, and actually young Turks and Republican Turkeys, or those who established Republican Turkey, are taken as representatives of new bourgeoisie. Okay, now. And the demands of rising bourgeoisie, they focus upon, but in, during Ottoman times especially, rising bourgeoisie were made up of two ethnically and religiously fragmented parts. One, and they were Greek, Armenian part, and there was also Muslim and Jewish. You see, ethnically and religiously fragmented, and hence a bourgeoisie, a rising bourgeoisie, and state reacting to it is problematic here, according to Kader. He also criticized that, and he exposes as the fourth one his own approach. Now, actually, he says from the beginning that his approach combines elements of the first three, but departs from them. Departs from them because he takes bureaucracy as a state. Or as if I have time, I will review together with Huri Cihan İslamoğlu, Çağlar Keyder published an article titled "The Ottoman Agenda," and they there proposed that instead of feudal mode of production in Europe, in contrast to feudal, cellular, decentralized feudal mode of production, there was an Asiatic mode of production in Ottoman Empire and China and India and other places. I will not go into this this article and the theoretical points of this article, but I will focus, and he doesn't go into that here, because it predates actually this approach. This approach is a further development of that approach that Kader developed together with Huri Cihan İslamoğlu. Now, he says that in his approach, he will first focus on the bureaucracy as a well-defined group or even a class. You know, this many people argues against this, you know, whether bureaucracy is a class or not. Okay, now. But Kedar asserts that it's a class, and hence he analyzes Ottoman and Republican transformation according to this conception and world system conception. And first, how this class bureaucracy responded to peripheralization by expanding capitalist world system. So that is the first, his first point. Second point is that this bureaucratic class survived. You see, it was, you see, Ottoman Empire was not colonized. Now, it might have been semi-colonial by, say, towards the end of, in the second half of 19th century and the beginning of 20th century, and at the end of the First World War, it was occupied, several parts of it, but a colonial state was not established. You see, the competition between the powers, France, England, Russia, Germany, kept the monarchical and sometimes constitutional monarchical form intact, and a bureaucracy, and fragmented bureaucracy, but still a bureaucracy. So he points this out. And then how in Ottoman socials, the basic social classes of Asiatic mode of production are producers, the peasants, and the state, which and the bureaucracy in the state, which gives security, protection against landlords, and from them taxes for the state, So peasant, peasant bureaucracy relationship and competition with the intermediaries, merchants and bourgeoisie. A bourgeoisie, as we discussed in the previous approach, which is bourgeoisie also is fragmented along ethnic and religious religious lines. So he takes this into account, and then he and because of this, actually, he thinks that the cultural or ideological instance is important. That so while analyzing class relationships, class analysis should include some ideological, cultural, the religious, ethnic elements into account, especially while focusing on the conflict between the bureaucracy and bourgeoisie during Ottoman Empire, during transition, and it is a different story after the establishment of republic and in various periods, and eventually how, especially after 1950, the date changes, how eventually bourgeoisie became dominant and bureaucracy became subordinate. But up to that point, bureaucracy was dominant and bourgeoisie subordinate. Okay, I think I tried to summarize this article, and it is important to understand this article in order to understand the book State and Class that we will be studying some chapters of it together. But before I am ending this lecture today, it's already an hour. Now I will go briefly into again Çağlar Kayder's review of a book by Karen Barkey. Karen Barkey. Now the title of the book is Bandits and Bureaucrats, The Ottoman Route to State Centralization, published in 1994, actually 1987 is Kayder's book being published, the State and Class, and but this one is some 5-6 years later. Now, Karen Barkey focuses on the decentralization period during 17th and 18th centuries, and the challenges to the bureaucracy, to the central state. Now, one of the challenges, ayans, emergence of ayans and lords. But if the bureaucracy is successful in subordinating them, the lords, which they became from 1808, Senedi İttifak, an agreement that the ayans and Sultan agreed, and eventually by 1830s, centralized state was much strongly established. Now, Karen Barkey talked about the processes. You see, in the case of Europe, we talk about emergence and formation of state, emergence and formation of state from a decentralized cellular feudal structure. In Ottoman Empire, we talk about a centralized state, as we have seen last week with the conquest of Istanbul, establishment of a center palace, how Mehmed II, Mehmed the Conqueror, was able to establish a classical centralized state, the Sultan's gaze dominance being in Istanbul, and from a Tower of Justice controlling the provinces in Balkans and in Asia Minor, and how his extensions, Beylerbeyi and other extensions, and finally at the ground level, at Timar manager, sipahis and peasants. Okay, now there is no problem when this central state structure is dominant, and central state and peasants are in collaboration with each other, supporting each other, symbiotic. But when, as in Europe, the conquest of Americas and great inflation and the establishment of a center starting to peripheralize other world systems, Ottoman Empire entered into a phase of decentralization. The Ayans emerged on the one hand, bandits, Eşkıya emerged on the other. Now, Eşkıya actually could exist even when there is a centralized state, yeah? The peasants and centralized bureaucracy are symbiotically existing, supporting each other. But then there are some state regulations which enters into the peasant populations. Now, some of them might rebel and go to the mountains, bandits. Some of them are locally developed into ayans or alas, as we discussed in Michael Meeker, and how they establish their own palaces, in a sense, in this period of decentralization. But how these ayans and alas are being integrated into the centralizing state and became a part of it, bandits are in the mountains, and eventually they die down. So he reviews Karen Barkey's book, and especially the Celalis, especially Celali revolts, is studied extensively by Karen Barkey, and Kedar points out what was the phenomenon of Celali revolts, and how the disorder that emerged at that time were being solved by the Ottoman Central State. Okay, now I will stop here and ask